Dr. Hilliard, I'm not big as all of the famous preachers. You know, then I hear about some of these big preachers that were all in the same league and fellowshipping and building each other and promoting each other and grew from each other and supported each other, how they turn it against themselves. And everybody going their separate ways. So it's a lot of stuff happening, but the thing that keeps you on track is that you know whom you have believed, and you know that God has no respect to a person, and you know that God is building something in you that's going to enable you. You know, they say that most people that become millionaires, they become millionaires after they get 60. So between 60 and 75, that's the time. Because you learn some sense, right? You got a lot of wisdom. Right? And you know, you learn what don't work, right? Then you settle down and you say, what? Well, I know what I gotta do. So I, you know, God gives you a lot of wisdom. And you know, that's the reason why you're able to stay focused, even though it seems like you have no reason to even believe or even entertain the idea that you can succeed at a certain point after you have gone through this and still haven't, you know, been what, haven't, you know, been successful in a whole lot of things that you have gone through. So that is the reason why prayer is important. And in prayer, I can see a whole lot of stuff. Oh, man. Amen. Well, just let God give you a few more ideas to put in, even in writing. How many people would want this? Well, how do the ideas come? They come mostly on your knees in prayer and going through a whole lot of negative stuff. Right? Sister Hill says she's going to do a book on the experience of a pastor's wife. what they have to deal with. You mean somebody would read it? Yeah, somebody would read that. So a whole lot of things work together for good that you don't have a clue. Things work together for good. Amen. Let's look at C. It gives you the energy and motivation to move forward regardless of adverse conditions and circumstances. Now, this is the problem that many times people have. They don't have the motivation. Somebody said, I'm not motivated. I'm not energized. And but when you really see where God is leading you, and when you can see the rainbow at the end of the what? You can see the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. that's good enough. All right, you can see the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. You're going to be motivated. But if your motivation is not strong, and prayer and the word, you know, just like, I mean, I wish there was some way that I could make y'all believe what I'm saying. Like, we're on this 30-day prayer thing, and every morning, boy, it is hard to get out of bed. Anybody can relate to that? Yeah. Amen. Sometimes, you know, I don't get there until 12 or 1 to bed. Then I have to get up around 4:30, 4:15. Sister Hill has to get up much earlier than I do, because all I do is just take me 5 minutes to get ready. Sister Dorothy said, well, I don't want to have the responsibility of opening the church. I can understand that because, you know, being a lady. So that means that it means almost like I put the 30-day prayer thing on. All right, because I have to be here to open up every morning. You understand what I'm saying? And it's been really difficult, but when God begins to, you know, for the first 30 minutes, he just be trying to cope and trying to stay awake and trying to see which way God wants to lead you. And you might not say a whole lot, meditation, but what happens is that when the Word of God really begins to flow through you, and now y'all know, as much word as y'all been reading, Brother Al gets up every morning, and you finally prayed through it and got some stuff. Well, the Bible says the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous avails much, right?
Amen.
I mean, his prayers worked too. You know, yes. Other people were praying, but it was largely, you know, his prayers too.
Amen.
But all of this information, the meditation and exhortation that we do, talking about prayer, and then we pray and pray and pray. This is designed to put something in you that will never cause you to quit when things are really going what? Negatively, when going adversely. And if you just meditate and hang around in prayer for a while, the Word of God is going to rise up during that prayer meeting somewhere. Is that right?
That's right.
And you might be at the point of almost ready to what? Throw in the towel.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And you say, I don't know, I don't see how in the world I can get beyond this. Oh, Jesus. It would be so much easier just to what? Give in and to give up. And after a while, the Word of God comes in. Yes, the Word of God is life to them that find it. You just begin to, you know, release those words.
Mm-hmm.
And I have found releasing the Word of God in prayer, man, is a powerful weapon. Oh, man. So, you know, just feed on the Word and let God bring it back to you in prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Just feed on that. Boy, that adds so much life. Oh, it changed your mind about everything you thought you can do, that you couldn't be. Well, the Bible says the Word is life to them that find it. Well, how do you find it? Amen. You gotta what? You gotta deal with it and read it and confess it and mull it and pray it. You know, a lot of times I'll pray the Word. I'll just pray. If I can remember to say it, if I don't, I can just read it in the Bible. I just look over it, then I just pray it in the Spirit. Amen. And those are two things, saints, that really will elevate your belief and really get you on a path where you will not take what? No or defeat or failure for an answer. But that prayer thing is a powerful, 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 powerful thing. Pray the Word. Every scripture you can think of, amen, just begin to say it to the Lord. So you're calling God to remember. You know, you're not just shooting out stuff in vain. You know, whenever the Word is released, amen, it begins to start what? Working for you. Start energizing, making life, and amen, changing the way you feel about yourself on the inside. The Word starts working when you release it. So release it by what? Saying it back to God, calling God to remember. So I think about every scripture I can think about, because everyone just gets more and more delicious, just juicy, finger looking good. Then I just say it, and I just say the word for about as much as I can think, Sister Shirley. I just say it. After I run out, at some point you run out. You know. Then you say, Halamini Shake La No Nandini Mishiki La La Moto Limite. And Sister Yasmin looking at me, she said, now what does that do? Well, I'll tell you. Well, you're calling the things that be not. See, there's a whole lot of ways you can release your faith. You don't always, because you're not going to be able to remember all of the word that you meditate.
Mm-hmm.
And if you probably don't deal with remembering scriptures, if you don't do well with that, then a whole lot of your prayer probably is going to be in the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of it.
Mm-hmm.
I like to switch from the word, pray the word, and pray in the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Sing in the spirit. Switch it up.
Yes.
Boy, you get, woo, when you just, whoo. My Lord, when you put it all in there together, man. Amen. Praise God. I'm telling you, I mean, the anointing is what stirred up what big time. Now, in the midst of that type of environment that you create through prayer, through meditation, praying in the Spirit, singing in the Spirit, God will begin to show you the end results of what he has in store for your life. Things you feel like you never would be able to accomplish or do, God will begin to assure you that this can become a reality to you. And you get so encouraged. And when you begin to praise the Lord, amen, that is called, the meditation and prayer is the spiritual experience that you can initiate. Whereas, like Joseph had the dream, that was something that God had to initiate. He couldn't initiate that dream, right? The visions that Ezekiel had, Daniel had, all of those things were initiated by what? God. And everybody don't dream, everybody don't have what? Visions. Everybody don't prophesy. But prayer and meditation is something that everybody can what? Activate. And it can work for you. And really, all of these things you see here under number 6, it gives you the energy and motivation to move forward regardless of adverse conditions and circumstances. All right, I like the 6D. It keeps you from wasting your time, talent, and treasure. For instance, if you choose to stay home instead of coming to church to get information, to expand your believing, or sitting on your talent, or putting your money in bags with holes, it keeps you from doing that. It keeps you from wasting your time, talent, and treasure. Amen. So you can see the importance of having this revelation aspect proponent working in your life, and the ability to see the things that you can't see. So you can see the importance of calling the things that be not as though they are. So that is, I would like for all of us in the month of October to experience another level in prayer, because I believe that we are so close to a major breakthrough. And, you know, just come and let go and let God. The devil the other day, a nice thing when she tested that. Well, I like people from the Holiness Church when they kind of quicken and get happy. Man, that blessed me. You know it was real. You know it was real. And that kind of breaking, boy, is what we really, really need to get back to. Because in those types of services where you're broken, you just let go and let God, you can resolve a whole lot of things that's going on with you. I mean, though, you can just work yourself out of all of the adversity and problems and adverse conditions and trials that you have ever had. So I just wanted to kind of focus on that. I'm going to let you all talk now. Here is what I want to challenge you with. The reason why we don't get involved in things that can really cause us to see the end from the beginning. I have some reasons and we want to discuss that, and I want to get y'all's opinions. It's probably because y'all can write this down, lack of understanding concerning the power of words. Now, whether it's in the spirit, words in the spirit under the anointing is just as powerful as praying the word. So you don't want to underestimate the power of singing in the spirit, praying in the spirit, and shabaking in the spirit. I mean, just raising your voice and letting it out loud. Amen. This might be one of the reasons why many times we draw back, we hold back, and we don't really get involved in things that can really change our lives and take our belief to a much higher realm, because of the lack of understanding concerning the power of words. Okay, I'm going to just throw these out, and then you might want to come in on that. Sometimes we don't view releasing words or saying what God says something as acting on the word, and as sometimes you have to do before God's power. Okay, We don't view releasing words as something that we have to do before God's power is released. So we don't see that verbalization is something that activates the power of God. Or we can say we don't see it as a manifestation of the faith that we have in our heart. But confession is very important. Releasing words is very important. That shows that you do have faith, and it also shows you that that's something that has to be done before you really get the full benefits, the full release that you are seeking, or the full manifestation that you are receiving. All right? Let me see if I can put it another way. Lack of understanding concerning the power of words, and we don't view it as something that we have to do before God's power is released. We don't see it as something that we have to do. We think that we just be quiet and just kind of stay in the spirit and you know, and be a little, you know, be casual, or, you know, just bow our heads. Okay, number three, not comfortable. Sometimes we are not comfortable calling things that be not as though they are. In other words, claiming something that has not manifested. Okay, that might be another reason why you don't see a whole lot of this boldness in releasing words, calling God to remembrance, and calling things that be not as though they are, and making a big fuss about the promises and the blessings that God has given us, because we don't see claiming something that has not manifested might be on the border of lying. Calling things that be not as though they are. Because you're in the spirit, I mean, you reach out and you say, thank you, Lord. I mean, you grab that thing, right? And you're calling things that what? Be not as though they are. Although you don't have it, but you what? You believe you what? You have it. And you feel like you have it when you're in prayer. Right? Feelings is very important. Okay? All right? Internalization, that's what we call for feelings, I think. Number four, you're too lazy to become, we're too lazy to focus on the part of the word needed for our deliverance and to speak them out. Now, which one of these areas you think most of us fall? Too lazy to focus on God's word? I mean, the part of the word that we need to focus on in order for us to get deliverance. And sometimes we're too lazy to what, let stuff come out of our mouth. It's just a lot easier not saying anything. It's a lot easier. Everybody agree? It's a lot easier what? Not saying anything. All right, so I'm putting these propositions before you. Sometimes people are not comfortable. Because I don't believe in this name it and claim it stuff. I don't believe in this blab it and grab it stuff. So a lot of people are not comfortable in calling things that have not manifested, saying, I believe that I'm healed. When in reality, the pain is still there, but God's word is saying that what you were healed, and you're agreeing with God. I believe that I am healed. Sometimes people are not comfortable with that. All right, so y'all can open up now. So what are some of the hindrances that keep people from really going out and making the word of God real and bringing the promises of God into the now and seeing the end result, you know, being able to see the end result from the beginning? What are some of the hindrances that y'all feel? Y'all might have something different than what I shared, but I just try to figure out the reason why sometimes the saints are so quiet. Maybe that might be no question. Why does that consensus so wide? It used to be that way. Every testimony service, the church where I grew up, every testimony service, pretty well every saint told what God was doing in their life. I mean, they were bold. After they finished that testimony, they got the little dance in.
Well, don't you think you get to sometimes, well, I don't know, a combination of things. I listened to Brother Williams say, you know, I don't get sick, but it took him to get to a point.
Don't blame it on me.
So my point was going to be that sometimes you have to have the experience, or you have to be to that point of need, or to that it is something I need, and so to make it important enough or to develop the urgency to get into the word where you need to be to get that. Right. I mean, right. Something, right. To me, I would think, I don't even think I really understood salvation. Yeah, you went to the font and you did all the formality, but it didn't become something to you until, or to me, until I had that need and I was just spent. I've done everything I know to do, Lord. Mm-hmm. Then I start getting into word. Where is it? What is it? What is this thing that, you know what I mean? It's supposed I've done everything I knew to do intelligently and what was logical, and I tried to logic the word and all that. When I ran out of me, then I could get into some of those things. So, you know, maybe sometimes people just haven't had the experience or haven't been in the word or come from different backgrounds and they just they haven't got to that.
Right. So it takes a while to get that mind revamped.
Oh, yeah, that transformation.
Right.
But just all in and of itself, I could read it, I could meditate it.
Right.
Until I think I had a need for it. That's a nice little book. It makes you go to sleep real good. So I don't know. To me, maybe that's a reason, and so people don't think, well, all that ain't necessary.
Right.
You know, because some backgrounds, I think, since you surely talked about, what are they, Jehovah's? Oh,
yeah.
You don't. Yeah. That ain't necessary. And strict as they are in the word and what they study, and they know it, and they can rattle it off, until you get a reality or something, have the experience.
Right, an experience, right. Well, experience is the ultimate thing that brings us up to that level where the things of God become reality. The experience is really true. So, all right, well, everybody can put your...
How do you get to the point, Sister Deborah, you say, Brother Williams says, not only does it say it, but it's his experience.
But you have the experience.
Yeah, don't get sick. You have to, it takes a deep desire not to be sick, and a deep hatred of it. And then you hold on to it, and then you find the reality of it in the Word,
right?
And you buy into what Jesus has done, until you find out all that you know about what Jesus has done, and you completely buy into that, and then. Something comes up. It comes the flu. It comes a headache. It comes whatever. things that you have experienced in the past. I know of these things out there. Then you just stand, just right there and say, "No, God's word is true. I'm on the side of God's word. I'm just staying right here, no matter what the symptoms or whatever comes up. I'm staying firm right here." And I believe that, like the Bible says, that if you resist the devil, he will flee from you. So you have to stand, so strong in that stance that you take, even against what the devil brings to you. Kind of like when Jesus was tempted in the wilderness. Definitely hungry. You hungry. all you gotta do is turn that rock to bread, you know, but then he would have to violate the word to do that. So you have to just stay with the word, to stay with the word, and eventually that devil will flee from you.
All right.
That spirit.
Well, you know, the thing is that you always call the things that be not, even though you might not be feeling that 100%, you never say that, oh, I feel so bad, I'm sick, I got this and that. You never say what you have. You always call the things that be not, you know, as though they are. It's not lying. You know, sometimes people say, we blab it and grab it. We name it and claim it. Well, if God names it, if God blab it, we can do the same thing, right? Mm-hmm. So you always call the things that be not. For instance, if you're not feeling your best and you just stand on the word of God and say, by his stripes I'm healed, I believe that I'm healed and I'm walking in health, then that confession will always become a reality at some point. And so that's one of the things. But, you know, the thing is that all of us got areas that our faith might be stronger, just like Brother Williams might be healing, but yours might be finances. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't think that you worry one minute about finances. You probably got enough money for all of us here.
I wish my faith for finances.
But there will come a point, you know, if you manage your money right, that you will not worry at all. You will not have any bills, you know nobody, and you can take cash for everything you do.
Yes.
At some point, you will come to that point. And that's, you know, so a lot of us got faith in a lot of different areas that's really, really strong. And, you know, for instance, like Brother Travis, I emulate him. Whatever I think about Brother Travis, I think about he's always punctual.
Yes.
I can always trust him to be here at 7 or before 7 or 10 o'clock, whenever, Saturday or Sunday morning. And I don't ever have to raise up here to make sure these doors open. I don't ever have to raise up here for nothing to make sure these doors are open, but I have to do it at 5 o'clock in the morning, because Brother Travis probably would be on that job, but he, you know, he has more responsibility now. So that's an area, that's a real strong area. You know, whenever I talk about areas that I need to be renewed in, he's my point of reference.
Yes.
Because he's always what? Punctual, you can always depend on him.
Yes.
And he's very strong in that area. How many other people got that going?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know why he chose that virtue. Well, I guess because we needed it. But what I'm saying, everybody got some area that God has really anointed you in. And in that area, you have probably reached perfection in that area. If you're really anointed. And so I like that. Like Sister Hill is a strong. She's just a real virtuous person. I mean, whatever, you know, you don't ever catch her doing something crooked. I mean, she don't have no tricks, and she don't. What you see is what you get. I mean, she's just genuine, just genuine. And if she gives you her word, brother, I mean, ain't no way that word is going to not be, you know, everybody, all saints are that way. Probably that started, you know, maybe, you know, way back. Maybe that, those are some virtues that run through her family, you know, that, and then God just added to that. Mm-hmm. But Sister Deborah, y'all got some virtues that are very, very powerful. I wish a whole lot of other North Siders had, so everybody got something going for you, I'm telling you.
But you can develop into anything that you...
Right, everything you focus on.
Yeah, that you put your mind to, you can develop into it.
Mm-hmm. Are everybody silent? Sister Deborah, you made a point.
Some people just quiet. Even when she's yelling, she's quiet. So, I mean, I don't know. So, I don't My mother was like that. She was a quiet, powerful woman, but she was quiet. She'd be over the corner doing her little thing, but she'd be quiet. I don't know if that's a... And I know, I was thinking of scriptures where, you know, the Lord says, or people did, they did the march around, or they crossed over,
right,
and they made noise, but
right.
I don't know.
Yeah, let's talk about this noise making. What do we have against
it?
What do we have against it? Everybody just quiet by nature. Everybody just, is that right?
I know.
Most of us are north side. We're just quiet by what? Nature. So we're not going to raise our voice too high. Don't expect it. Am I speaking for everybody?
Probably outside of this room.
Tell me to get outside. Tell me to get outside.
Quiet in this room.
Change the venue. Yeah, turn on the game.
I wonder what the parable of sower. How much of that will come into play in line with what we're studying about right there and now. Where, you know, I guess it talks about different conditions of the heart and